time in which the Lord had to tear down the Tower of Babel. So you had a lot of things happening, and this is a transition chapter, because it begins to look at a famine. Up to this point, God has looked at the world, he's looked at the nations, and the nations were formed at Babel because so many of them talked the one language, but they didn't obey God. And we know the story, because God came down and made them all to speak different languages, which is why we get our languages today. I don't know how many hundreds of languages and dialects there are in the world, but whatever they are, God gave them. Amen? And if you didn't think about it, God gave whales to talk to each other. And they have a certain language and a pitch and a certain tune they learn from a child. And then that pack of killer whales, orcas, knows that thing. We know that because we went out to sea world enough to know they communicate. And that's something, you know. I wouldn't know where to go to study whale talk. But the whales can tell you we communicate, and we want to mess you up. We don't know how to do it. You won't know what we're talking about. Well, God given all language. We're going to look at that tonight as we come to the chapter 12 in the book of Genesis. And our focus is really not going to be on so much languages. It's going to be on the sterling truth that righteousness will exalt a nation and sin is a reproach to any people. We're going to look at the fact that Abraham believed God and it was reckoned unto him for righteousness. Righteousness. God wants you to believe him. And believe him means have confidence and believe and trust in what he says. Amen? So, in looking at that, why would you look at that? Because that's the main ingredient of our salvation. And that is the real heart and soul of how we to live every day. Where we walk by faith and not by sight. And we got to bring that faith into the circumstances, situations, challenges that we have to face. Amen? So it's not just we have faith to come to church. Listen, you got to have faith to go to work and stay on a job.
Amen.
It's tough to stay on a job. Is that right? Everybody don't love you and don't like you because you were there. So you got to have faith in God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you now for the power of your word. Now bless us to study. In Jesus' name, amen. Now it says here in chapter 12, I want to welcome our internet audience. If you're watching, thank you so much for tuning in tonight as we look at the word of God in Genesis 12. Verse 1 says, now the word the Lord had said to Abram, get thee out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless you, I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is a mighty God who's speaking a covenant. A contract. I will live up to what I say, and you will be blessed according to what I say. That's how much God loves us. So if you will, he chooses Abraham. And where does Abraham live at this point in the chapter? He lives in a place called Ur of the Chaldeans, and it's called ancient Mesopotamia. And it was being today, if you went over there, it'd be around the Persian Gulf. So the Persian Gulf is rich with biblical heritage because many of our ancient sites are around the Persian Gulf. So here is Abraham in Ur of the Chaldeans, and it would be Iraq or somewhere near there. And he is now in with his father, and Abraham's generation, Ur of the Chaldeans, they were idol worshippers. They didn't serve God. So you had a nation of idol worship, in which God says, you know, I just destroyed Sodom. Well, he hadn't destroyed Sodom anymore, but I just destroyed the Tower of Babel because I wanted to make nations, and I told the people, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth. And Nimrod, the Nemesis, who is Nimrod, the prefigure of the Antichrist, gathered all the people together and said, up, let's make this skyscraper, which would be the tower, to go up to heaven. And there we would usurp, we would take over heaven. In other words, he was going to do a coup d'etat. He was going to fight and think that a physical tower could get him to his spiritual place. He was mixed up as he could be. Let's build a tower to heaven and let's go into heaven. When he got up there and stepped off the last brick, he was going to fall for a long time off that tower. But he did not. The real essence of it, they didn't obey God. God said, be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth, which means go spread yourself among the earth. So they gathered in one place. This shows you human government as well, because it was one man ruler, everybody following him blindly, and if the man goes off a cliff, everybody follows him with and falls in with him. So he says, let's build, and they decide to. Now God goes down to the tower and sees that the people are corrupt and evil, so he just speaks a word, blows his breath on them, and all of them start speaking different languages. They couldn't handle brick because they couldn't understand the language. They couldn't handle mortar. They couldn't move anything because they were all talking a different language. Then they scattered, and from that we get all the nations. Now God would go to a heathen nation like Ur of the Chaldeans and get a family. So it moves from government and all nations to one single family with one single person called in that family. And that call came upon Abram. And when we join him in chapter 12, he said that God had already called him. Now the Lord, watch the wording so you can get the timing and the picture. Now the Lord had said, so the Lord is not saying in the book of Genesis at 12, because he already had said, if I ask you to do something, and then I come back again and say, now I told you to do it, and then you know there's a precedent for it. I've already asked you. So the Lord says that he had already asked Abraham to get up and go to a place I will show you. Now let me follow you, because let me lead you, because in chapter 11, you find that Abraham and his father's name was Terah. Terah worshiped idol gods. Abraham's brothers worship idol gods. So the Lord had told Abraham to get up and move. Terah decided to go with him, but the Lord said, I want you to separate yourself from your family. Now watch this. Abraham had to have partial obedience because he took his family with him. Terah went to the edge of a place of the Chaldeans called Haran, and he stayed there. Terah was some 200 years old. Abraham did not fully obey God at the first call. How do you know that? Because it was after Terah died that God called to him again and said, you've got to go. So in other words, he took his daddy so he could understand who's given the orders. Isn't that amazing? It wasn't something God did out of malice, but he said, I called you. And he just clumped at a place called Haran, and he stayed on the outskirts for 5 years or so. And I said, no. I want to take your daddy so you can move. And he took his daddy. All right? Now then the Lord had said, and now watch what Abraham does in chapter 12. So Abraham, verse 4, we catch up with the whole action now. Verse 4 says what? So Abraham departed as the Lord what? Did he learn the second time? Yeah, that's kind of like old Jonah. Is that right? We don't hear, we are hard-headed people now. You can say amen. You can say that's not the hard-headed man. So the Lord is gracious and merciful. So in the hard-headedness of Abraham, he speaks to him a second time. Same way with Jonah. Jonah hopped on a ship going in the opposite way to a place near Italy. And the Lord had to catch up with him. Is that right? Then the word of the Lord, he had a whale-like experience. Then the word of the Lord came to him a second time. He got up and went around Nineveh, which was 3 days in a day. Because he had that underwater experience with that whale. Amen? So here's Abraham, or Abram in this case, having the spirits of losing his father, and now the word of God comes to him, and he departed as the Lord, as to the same extent, as to the same. When God said it, he jumped high, Lord, the way you want me. The Lord, and so he went, they had taken him, and Lot went with him, and Abraham was 70, how? When he departed from Haran. Which means another point. Age is no God and no respect of your age. How you think you lived this long in the first place? Is the Lord let you live? Amen? Yes. Lord, I'm old. I said, wait a minute, who are you talking to? And I know your birthday and I know the hairs on your head. If I want to call you at this age, that's my business.
That's right.
And I can call you at any age and I can use you as effectively as if you were 21. Amen? I'm glad God is no respecter of person, and he's no respecter of age. Two things. Amen? You don't get retired. How you retire on God? And you still live. Amen. You don't retire on God. God can use you. I can tell you, an old man like Caleb, who was 85 or so years old, and he climbed the mountain and beat up the giants and took his mountain in the promised land. He had no business at 85. He should have been in a rocking chair or bouncing his grandchildren. But he got him off that rocking chair, took those giants down, cleared the land, and Caleb had daughters and left his daughters some land. Amen.
Amen.
First daughters in the Bible that owned some land. Let me move on. All right, here we go. So now we go. Then Abraham took Sarah, his wife, and Lot, his brother, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran. Meaning they had some servants. You bought people as servants in those days. Amazing, but that was true. So they had the servants, they brought them, and they brought everybody. And Abraham was pretty well off. And they departed to go to the land of where? Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. And you know, Canaan was one of the sons of Ham. And Ham was a dark man. So if you're talking Canaan land, you're talking dark people. You're talking dark people. So Abraham went in a place where there was brothers and sisters, huh? They were dark. Amen? And the Canaanites, and they got along. By the way, Abraham got along with the Canaanites. Amen?
Amen?
So here is this moment in time, and then God would speak to him. Abraham passed through the land to the place of Shechem. That was a place that was significant as far as the terebinth tree of Amorah, and the Canaanites were then in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, here's this grant of land, and it's like a deed, only it's not a written document, but it's from the word of God. Can you trust God's word better than a written document? Because man will always try to write the fine print and trick you and mess you up. Amen? But here's God granting land. Now, who has the authority to grant land over God? Nobody. God, if God says, I'm going to give it to you, you can guarantee he's going to be given to you. So the Lord says, to your descendants, I will do what? Give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared unto him. Amen?
Amen?
So God gives him something, and God, in other words, backs up his covenant. Get thee out of the land, I'll make of thee a great nation, and nations will come from you, and all the families of the earth will be blessed. Why? Because Abraham believed God. Why? Because Abraham got out of Haran, and Ur of the Chaldees went 600 miles without knowing specifically where he was going. His own star wasn't working. He had to trust God. He didn't have a global tracking system. He had a heart for God. And God said, I'm going to show you. And not one of us today would go as far as El Paso without knowing where we're going. Amen?
Amen.
That's about 500 to 600 miles. It takes nearly a day to get out there. Amen. They got the speed limit. You have to break this law to get out there. Some low flying. But it's a long way to El Paso.
Yes.
And so here was Abraham going the distance like El Paso, not knowing where he would go, but trusting God. And that belief, let me just say, if belief were and faith were a machine, it would be to me like a ski lift or some vehicle you could get in. And when you got in, you go higher and higher. Is that right? So what that faith is, it's your belief level in God that takes you higher and higher and higher. And it's that belief that God is pleased with. For without faith, it's impossible to do what? Please God. Why? Because he that cometh to him must believe that he is. That God exists in the first place. And Abraham really had to deal with, who is this calling me? Who is this talking with me? My father have two little dogs, and he's worshiping. We might think of dogs as voodoo dogs. But daddy looking at those dogs again, praying to them. And so he had a problem. Who's talking with me? I'm God. I'm God El Shaddai. I'm the one who made the earth. And you are? So he had to break with his father and the teachings of all those around him, step into that little ski lift and say, I'm going to believe God. And everybody would say, are you nuts? Are you going to go somewhere and you don't know where you're going? Well, how would they question you in your house? I'm getting ready to go. And they say, you lost your mind. They put it on that big alert they have on the freeway. Somebody lost their mind. They're traveling in an SUV and they got lights and pretty little. Huh? They go with the, and please bring them back home because they're crazy. Huh? But here's Abraham saying, I'm going to believe God. I'm going to believe God, and it's going to break with tradition. It's going to break with the mores, and I'm just going to believe God. And so God says, I'm pleased that you believe me, you trust me, and watch, believe. You have confidence in my word. And that's what it takes to get into that little compartment, that vehicle of a ski lift. And a ski lift can take you over, what, mountains and everything else, and get you to the next stop, and you look around, and you're ready to ski down a mountain. Now, I've never skied, nor would I be foolish enough to try. I watch it from a distance, take my camera, and let's go on in the lodge and eat some pigs and poop. But the whole idea was, you have to believe God to get in it, then I have to believe God that he's going to take me somewhere. And I got to stay in there and stay with him long enough to reach the destination. And that's exactly what Abram did. Abram believed God, and when God gets to the destination, he said, I'm going to make of you a great nation. I'm going to make you a great nation, and then I want you to go through the land. And then the Lord appeared to him and says, to your descendants, I'm going to give this land. And there he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. So here is Abraham being blessed by the Lord. And then he tells him later to go out and look at the stars. Stars at night are big and bright. Deep in the heart of Texas. Well, they're big and bright over in the land of the Persian Gulf. And God says, look at the sky and tell if you can number the stars in the sky. If you can, then this will be, if you will, equivalent to all the nations and the people that will come from you. You will be the father of many nations. Isn't that amazing? Because you believe me. And so this is a promise that God gives. And listen, God says to Abraham, I am your God, and I am your protection, your shield, and I am your great reward. Yes. Now, what does all that mean to us? Because it was said to Abraham, could it have any rational application to us? Yes, because the same God who blessed Abraham is the same God who wants to bless you. Why? Because there is no changing in God. There is no vacillating or shadow of turning. Because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Why? Because there is no big eyes and little hues with God. He loves us all the same. So what God said to Abraham, we get the blessings of Abraham if we follow the faith, if we get in that stadium and believe God against the odds. Amen? God gives you the same thing. We get the benefits of Abraham. There's a song I heard on the radio called The Blessings of Abraham. And it's a beautiful little song, and if I had it, I would play it. But we get the blessings of Abraham because we're the children of Abraham. And as Abraham got blessed, maybe we don't want a great nation of people. We just want to do well while we with the light we have. Amen? All right, let's go further in, and we're going to move this to the close. Y'all can close that. They can close that door, the outside door, so it won't get too many ads. All right. Now, Abraham comes to a trial, and I want to just try this out. Because Abraham, I think I got a little time, though. All right. What's my time? 7:30? All right. I'm going to finish the next schedule. All right. Here we go. So here we go. With Abraham now has journeyed all the way to the promised land, to Canaan. And the Bible says in verse 8, this is cool. And he moved from there to the mountain east of Bethel, and he did what? He pitched his tent where within Bethel, between Bethel on the west side and Ai. That's the best way I've found. I looked up that name all evening. Ai is what I've been saying for 20 years. I'm going to say it again because I don't think they can say the word any other way. All right, on the east. Now, there he built an altar to the Lord and he called on the name of the Lord. It's important to know and remember who you are when God has called you. When you have called and stepped forward to say, I'm a Christian. Worship is that connection that constantly gives you the food, the supply, the nutrients you need to walk in an otherwise hostile world. So this altar building, this worshiping God, was tagging up with the Lord to get the energy, to get the strength he needed. So he built an altar in both those places where Shechem was, and then he gets to the place of Bethel and Ai. Why is that significant? Well, Bethel represents the house of God. The very name Bethel means house of God. And there, Ai means heap of ruin. What I have looked up says heap of ruin. What does this mean? Lord, in the world, what are you talking about? He mentions his tent between the house of the Lord and a heap of ruin. Is that our dualistic nature in us, where we have good and we have a touch of evil? And isn't evil our ruin? And so we have Abraham dealing with two places and in the middle of them. And that's where we are. And God, we have to make a decision to stay with God or to let the evil reign. You understand? Yeah. So we could go to a touch of evil, do it our way, selfishly. Our way is selfish. Amen? God's way is righteous. What made Abraham righteous was he did things God's way until he got to this part where that was a famine. Now, a famine is a place of absence of food or a lack of food. So you either have a complete absence or a lack, a severe lack of food. And that will get your temper up quicker than anything when you get hungry. Huh? Not hungry, hungry. Huh? And so now he's dealing with the issue of what do I do when I'm hungry? And how do I handle it? And what you find here and what you will find when you read it tonight is that Abraham decided to go down into Egypt. All right? He made a decision. What is this significant? Because in that verse, when you find that he decides to go down into Egypt, the Bible says, and Abraham journeyed, he journeyed going still toward the south. Now there was a famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt to dwell there, for the famine was severe. Bingo, that's verse 10. Notice what's missing out of verse 10. God. Notice what's missing out of verse 10. That God would tell him what to do, or that he would ask God. He just decided. He up and decided, let's go to Egypt. And when you go to Egypt, you geographically from the high ground he was on, went downward toward the sea level. So in other words, he went down geographically. What are you saying? He went down morally. Yeah. He went down spiritually. Yeah. He left God. And then he went into Egypt. Now when he gets close to Egypt, to show you he was getting away from God, he told Sarah, baby, listen, I want you to do something for Dad. Huh? They say that you a beautiful woman. Now, Sarah was 65, so she was a good-looking 65. Amen, brother, 65. And he said, when we get there, pre-adventure, they will see that you're beautiful and speak unto Pharaoh, unto you, about you. And for me, they will kill me, and they will save you, and you will become the wife of Pharaoh, or something like that. So say, for daddy's sake, that I'm your brother. Now, a preacher back in Arlington, Bishop Jakes, this summer, that was a great preacher talking about the neighborhood he came from. He called that pimping your wife. That's what he said. I said, that's a horrible term. But he said, running the hood, that's what it would be. Because he said, whatever Pharaoh say to you, you go and deal with Pharaoh, and it'll be good for me. Now, that may be a harsh term, but let me graduate it to this point. Abraham was looking out for himself, and the vehicle through which God was going to bless him was his wife. To show you how much he departed from God, he went down into Egypt and had a conversation that did not build up his wife nor be based on the foundation that God had told him. He came up with his own scheme, and that further degraded him and degraded his wife. The vehicle of blessing through which God was going to bless and make many nations was Sarah. Why is it the very thing we're going to use, we discard? Why is a voice that can sing, people go and put crack cocaine on their voice? Just like Whitney Houston did, the first thing she did was lose her 5 octaves, and she got less and less in her ability to sing. Why is it when God gives you the ability to talk and you can persuade people, you go among the wrong people and they got you doing the thing they doing, and they should be doing what you doing? You look more like the world than they do. So the very vehicle of blessing, which was Sarah, he degraded and gave over to Pharaoh to do what he wanted. And that's when God sent the first plagues of Egypt. Not with Moses, Moses in Exodus, we're still in Genesis. In order to wake up Pharaoh, God sent plagues and great plagues upon Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said, listen here, why'd you tell me that she was your sister? Aren't you a holy man? And you're going to come in here lying to me? You know she ain't your sister. I could have taken her and married her, and God would have slapped me down with plagues. Now get out of here. That's what he said. Then he took all the hogs. Now we didn't have hogs, but all the cattle, all the things he had. He had become rich. He had become rich, he and Lot, because Sarah was in the harem of the Pharaoh about to be married. Pharaoh gave her alleged brother all these gifts. So the first time riches are mentioned in the Bible, they ill-gotten. The first time riches are mentioned in the Bible is because Abraham went down in his thinking, down in his witness, down in his walk. He got rich crookedly. Yeah. God would have gone bless him another way. But he couldn't wait. How many people can't wait on God? Got to go forge something themselves. And when they forge it, they get caught. That's what's happening to Congressman Uriste downtown. Had a scheme on getting oil and oil fracking, and he sold it like a Ponzi scheme. Now he's sitting in the hot seat right downtown on Durango in the federal court building. Because he couldn't wait. So here was Abraham caught by Pharaoh. You know it's bad to be caught by anybody. But with Pharaoh, go ahead, where's it to believe? Huh? Pharaoh said, get out of here. And he returned. Abraham returned. I'm going to end it right here. He returns to the place where he had built that altar between Bethel and Ai. He goes back to the place where he first prayed unto God, and he says, Lord, have mercy on me. Do you know God accepts us back even though we have flaws in our heritage? That God did not say to Abraham what Pharaoh said, I'm through with you. God says, I'm bringing you back to the place where you first found me. Now I'm going to use you. But I want you to follow me. And I want you to follow me and not your own hunches and not your own misguided direction. I want you to listen to my voice. And when you hear my voice, I want you to follow me, because my sheep, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and know, and another they will not follow. God wants exclusivity on your mind and your ability to think. He's not going to take you like a robot and make you do things. He's going to present things and your freedom of choice. And that's what God wants. He wants you to love him out of your freedom of choice. If God wanted you to be a robot to love him, he would have made you one. And you would have no thought. It would be all instinct. I'm nothing on it. And you just go crazy like a bug, huh? But God told you, I want you to come to that decision, because you are a reasoning, rational being. And I want those who love me to love me out of their free spirit. And then I will bless them. And it's a matter of choice. You can decide you want to love yourself, and that's what Eve did. She saw the fruit and loved herself, because she wanted to be as God, equal with God. It would never happen, but the devil talked her into it. And Adam stood up there and let the devil do it. And they both got kicked out because they didn't listen. And Abraham goes 600 miles from Ur of the Chaldeans, walking and cameling and carrying on. And he gets to the promised land. He could trust God for 600 miles, but he couldn't trust him from Tuesday to Wednesday when it came to food. I'm going down into Egypt. It's something you've gone down to. You've gone down, and you need to come up out of. You need to come up out of your sin. You need to come up out of your fallacies and flaws. Come up out of those things that have messed you up with God, and get back in that ski lift, which is faith, and trust God from day to day. Abraham came back, and even if the land was still in famine, Abraham did not miss a meal. Because God supplies our needs according to his riches and glory. Amen. The widow of Zarephath ran out of meal, and it's that much for her son and for her. But she listened to the prophet Elijah, and he said, make me the land. Give me a love offering. Give me a peace. Make me some food. I got some water ready. I'm okay. And so he was there to challenge her faith. And she had to give her last in order to get 3.5 years of grocery. Amen. That's the way God does. He lets you get to your last. I'm going to try you. Amen. Negro, I'm going to try you. Huh? What do you really got in you? I'm going to try you. And it's hard to let go of your last for the Lord. Because you, what am I going to do, Lord? Is that us?
Yes.
Little baby with drawers on. Put my where my mom? Lord Jesus, I'm telling the truth. Where my mom? Yours is in his hands. What did I have y'all do Sunday? Hold your hands up and hold them out because God's going to put something in.
Yes.
And if you believe God, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things you can't see. But if you cup your hands, that's the hope. And if you hold them together and lift them up to God, God will put something in.
Yes.
Now that's all my time. But God, over my black cow, make green grass, and then make white milk and yellow butter. But I'm going to eat some in the morning. God bless you.